Random House Audio presents Getting Organized in the Google Era, How to Get Stuff Out of Your Head, Find It When You Need It, and Get It Done Right by Douglas C. Merrill and James A. Martin. Read by the author, Douglas C. Merrill. Preface. Second verse, same as the first. Herman's Hermits, I'm Henry VIII, I am. What, another book on organization? No way, you're probably thinking. I mean, does the world really need another book on how to get organized? That's okay. I thought the same thing when I first began to write this book. At the time, I was the chief information officer at Google, whose corporate mission is to organize the world's information. So apparently, there were people who thought I must have useful insights to share about the challenges of being organized in the information age. Out of sheer politeness, I sat down with my colleague and now most excellent co-author, Jim Martin, to talk about organization. As it turned out, I found I had plenty of new ideas to offer. But first, please allow me a brief digression. Picture, if you will, a small, thin young boy with a buzz cut and thick glasses. He's seated next to his mother at a long, dark wooden table. The table's too high for him, so his legs dangle from his chair as he sits up as tall as he can. It's a summer afternoon during the 1970s in Conway, Arkansas, a small bucolic town. Outside, it's hazy hot and stagnant. Only the mosquitoes are moving. Inside, it's cool with the air conditioner humming in the background. Despite the languid pace of this late summer afternoon in this quiet southern town, the boy's pulse is racing. His mother is patiently guiding her son through the multiplication tables. It's not the first time they've done this, nor even the second. Practicing addition, subtraction, and multiplication, sometimes for hours at a time, every summer before school starts, has become a routine for them. If you knew this boy's family background, you'd have expected him to be a math whiz. His father has a doctorate in physics, and his mother holds two master's degrees. One older sister followed in her father's footsteps to earn an undergraduate degree in physics. The other has a degree in British literature of the Middle Ages. His older brother holds a doctorate in, of all things, mathematics. And yet, here's the youngest child, struggling summer after summer to learn something as basic as multiplication. What a failure he is. He constantly worries everyone will figure out he's not smart enough, or not good enough, or that he's an embarrassment to his family. As you've probably guessed by now, I am that boy. Or I was. I'm taller now, with longer hair. But I still remember how that secret fear set my heart pounding. Though I didn't know it then, I was bad at math because I'm dyslexic. Dyslexia is a learning disorder affecting some 10 million kids in the United States alone. Because dyslexia causes the brain to reverse numbers, dyslexics often have a hard time in math. Reading is difficult, too, because dyslexics also reverse letters. Back then, dyslexia was far less recognized and diagnosed than it is today, and I was in high school before I realized it was the root cause of my learning difficulties. Luckily, my parents were patient with me, and my siblings helped me with my homework. I worked hard, and over time I managed to do reasonably well in academics. Eventually, I too earned a doctorate. Perhaps not so surprisingly, mine is in cognitive science, the study of how people learn and solve problems. I studied cognitive science because I wanted to figure out how to help that boy, and others like him, stop feeling so scared, sad, and anxious about learning. In my research, I found that most of the ways we teach math, and other subjects, are poorly designed for how our brains actually work. Dyslexic or not, most of us have trouble learning math, not because we're stupid or lazy, but because we're simply being taught in the wrong ways. In fact, I realized that most of how our world is structured is wrong for how our brains work, which makes being organized extremely difficult. I'll explain this further in Chapter 1. Given all these obstacles to learning, on top of my dyslexia, how did I, that scared kid, end up earning a doctorate and becoming the CIO at Google? Well, I did spend an inordinate amount of time in punk clubs, but I don't think that's relevant here. Kidding aside, here's the deal. Because learning was such a struggle for me, I spent a lot of time thinking about how to get around the limitations my learning challenges posed. I worked hard to develop techniques and systems to reduce the stress on my brain and help me focus on only the information I really needed to learn. I couldn't take anything for granted. These extra efforts I made, these systems I developed for organizing information, helped me eventually succeed in school. Years later, as luck would have it, my efforts paid off in my career too. I was hired to help Google organize the world's information, partly because I'd been practicing to do that very thing, on an admittedly much smaller scale, since first grade. Spending both my childhood and entire adult life developing systems of organization has taught me many things. Not least is the fact that many of us are disorganized today because we haven't taken into account our brain's inherent limitations, and we haven't found ways of working around those constraints. My brain's shortcomings happen to include dyslexia, but the fact is we're all brain-constrained in some way. Take memory, for example. Our short-term memory can hold between only 5 and 9 things at once. With endless to-do items competing for our attention, plus the countless bits of information we gather all day, it's no wonder we're constantly forgetting things. Shifting from one task to another complicates matters, too, by knocking out what we had in our short-term memories. That's one reason that our brains simply can't handle multitasking. Sadly, our brains aren't good at making decisions either. For example, too often we make choices based on our fear of losing something rather than our hope of gaining something. Considering the many choices we're faced with at any given time, it's no wonder we feel mentally drained by day's end. Our brains aren't the only reason we're disorganized and stressed. We're also held back by many of the ways in which the world is structured today. Without realizing it, we continue to organize our lives around outdated societal structures and beliefs that are totally wrong for what we need now. For example, businesses today continue to revolve around a schedule whose original purpose was to organize factory workers, even though we are largely an information and service economy today, and adhering to the factory schedule creates stress and lots of other problems. We still send our children to school based on a schedule devised long ago so they could work the fields, and I don't mean baseball fields. We live by rules laid out in a time long gone, a time before life centered on computers, when only one parent worked, when knowledge was power, when the commute between home and office was usually brief, and the boundaries separating the two were distinct. Ah, the good old days. And yet, our current societal structures depend on our having excess brain power so we can always remember when to drop the kids off at soccer practice or ballet class, where our keys are, and when that all-important sales presentation is due, and who needs to approve it. This enormous disconnect between how we think our brains and societal structures work and how they actually work, combined with all the information vying for our attention, is at the heart of our disorganization today. This problem is also compounded by the fact that, if anything goes wrong, our stress levels go supernova on us. In fact, your stress probably compelled you to pick up this book, and thank you for that, by the way. Maybe it causes you to write to-do lists that never shrink, to worry how you'll find time to help your children with their studies, to feel, as I often do, that you're always behind. Let's face it, disorganization causes stress. Stress makes you flounder. Floundering makes you even more stress. That makes you flounder more. It's the perfect definition of a downward spiral. I know something about that spiral. I've been caught in it before. You run and you run to catch up with the sun, but it's sinking. Pink Floyd, Time. When Jim and I started working on this book, I was in the middle of switching jobs, changing cities, and searching for a new house. I had just left Google to become president of EMI Music's digital business and its chief operating officer of new music. EMI is one of the top 4 music labels. EMI hired me in part to help the company navigate the complicated technical and organizational challenges the industry has been struggling with because of consumers' shift to digital music. As both a music and a tech junkie, it was a challenge dear to my heart. But moving from Silicon Valley to Los Angeles caused me to face a lot of other challenges too. I thought I would never learn where the grocery store in my new city was, let alone how my new company worked. I was no longer able to follow the systems and structures I had built for myself. Suddenly, I was that boy with a buzz cut again, feeling like the only one who doesn't get it, who's struggling, who's staying up late trying to figure out how to do some task that should be easy. I was incredibly stressed. Luckily, I worked my way through the stress using the various organizational techniques I developed, and which I'll describe later in this book. So my dyslexia gave me a vested interest in understanding how we learn. My studies in cognitive science helped me see how the brain and our societal structures work against us. With this knowledge and perspective, I came to understand the importance of identifying the root causes of disorganization. Unfortunately, that's something most books on organization gloss over or ignore. Not this one. I want this book to help you understand why you're not as organized as you'd like, because, as you'll soon see, it's not your fault. There are forces larger than you conspiring to keep you feeling scattered. The good news is that you're far from powerless. I'll share with you strategies for overcoming the challenges that cause you to be unproductive and stressed at work and in your personal life. I won't be talking about things like how to organize the clothes in your closet. That's something you could teach me. Rather, I want to share with you my techniques for organizing the tasks and information in your life so you can achieve your goals more efficiently and effectively and with the least amount of worry. Similarly, I'm not going to offer one-size-fits-all notions of being organized. Always keep your email inbox empty? Arrange computer files into folders within folders? Get financial statements delivered electronically? If I had to go through life doing things like that, I'd be forever DOA, disorganized on arrival. The truth is, even if they may sound like good organizational principles, I don't do any of these things. It's not because I can't. It's because I figured out ways that are better suited to the world in which we live and work today. For example, my years at Google helped me understand how technology can help us to organize, rather than be overwhelmed by, the information that assaults us every day. I saw how technology can help make our lives easier by helping us be more organized and efficient. And I saw how it can help reduce our stress levels by minimizing the strain on our memory and letting our brains work for, rather than against, us. That's why I wanted to write this book, to share with you the methods I have developed, some use technology, some don't, for getting around the limitations our brains, our societal structures, and our personal constraints impose on us. My goal is to help you develop your own system, one that works for you, for being more organized, more successful, and less stressed. I want to help you stop doing things that waste time and energy you didn't even know you were wasting. And I want to help you decide what's important to do and what's important not to do. Through awareness, effort, and better organization, you'll find yourself in an upward spiral. Each day will bring you a bit more clarity and excess mental capacity, which you can fill with things that are a lot more fun, productive, and important than stress. That's the kind of spiral I like. What's with the lyrics? I've been writing for a long time, in different formats, with different goals, and for different audiences. But one thing has remained constant. For many years, I have inserted music in one way or another into my writing. I have a deep love of music. Whenever possible, my life plays out against a backdrop of my favorite music. For example, as I write these words, I'm listening to Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.